Katia, I know that you gon' hear this. I'm the man. Yeah, I said it. Bitch, I'm the man. Don't you forget it. The way you walk, that's me. The way you talk.
What's up, y'all? I'm Ree.
And I'm Chris. And this is Perspective, the podcast.
And today we have a special guest.
Got Nora in this joint.
Nora, right?
Yeah. First of all, how you feeling, Nora? How you feeling today?
I'm feeling good. Feeling great.
Okay, that's what's up. That's what's up. I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, it's all right.
Hey. Okay. I just wanted to see, you know what I'm saying, make sure
I'm just going
to
let them know she's an interviewer.
Today. Yeah.
She's my friend. She's my client. She's my girl. But today, she's an interviewer.
So, let them know what we're doing.
Okay, so this episode is entitled Life After a Tragedy. So we're basically going to be giving you all a little inside peek into our life, into some events, you know, a series of events that happened leading up to where we are now.
And I'm just going to be the one navigating you all, giving you all a peek into the perspective of Chris and Ree and how life is after a tragedy. So I'm just going to start it off with like a little icebreaker, you know.
Break the ice.
Break the ice. Break before we get into the little.
To be too serious.
Exactly. Yeah, okay. Yeah. So, all righty. So, Chris, Ree. Say for instance, y'all like in the car, you know, on the way to a family function. You know, everything is cool, it's breezy, y'all in a cool, good mood. But she just hears your phone going off. You ain't trying to like, you know, check it on some crazy stuff. You know, Cree in the back is like, you trying to go ahead and get her together to go ahead and get in the house. Y'all done pulled up in the house, all right. But she just like, okay, who is this blowing my man's phone up? You know how we are. Like, okay.
Right.
I'm like, I know my man, it's my man. Yeah. But who is this? Who is this hitting him up?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So she checks it and sees something that she don't like. Not necessarily saying like, you know, on some cheating type stuff.
Yeah.
But she just don't like the vibes that she's seeing.
Yeah.
All right, so you know how we are when we on code.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you come up to a place, even though y'all not really feeling it. You're not really feeling in the mood, but you're gonna present yourself to everybody else like everything good and good
for
in
sure.
The house.
You gotta keep everything, you know.
But what she saw,
yeah,
it rattled her just a little bit too much.
Mm-hmm.
So, Ree, I'm gonna flip this for you too.
Okay.
Vice versa, if a shoe was on the other foot and she was in the back getting crazy, and you just hear her phone going bing, bing, bing.
Yeah.
Are you, Ree, gonna be like, I'm gonna address this now? Or you're gonna be like, let me just wait until after we get from the family, just in case
you
get a little heated. Y'all at a family function. Are you just gonna wait till like, okay, we get back to the house? Or you gonna be like, pause, put baby back in the car seat. We need to go ahead and talk about something real quick, baby.
I ain't gonna lie, like we gonna stay at the family function. But I'm gonna be like, he already know my mood gonna be off.
Yeah.
Like, I could try to ignore him, but I'm still, he know me, so I'm gonna be like, what's wrong?
Oh,
I'm
God.
Be like, nothing.
Yeah.
But I'm gonna check it when I get home. But my mood is gonna say it out. It's gonna say it out. Like,
so you feel like you might as well, you know, at least pull him to the side and be like, baby, I saw something, but we gonna talk about it later.
I ain't gonna answer.
I feel like I don't want to pull him to the side here because then he going to be looking all moping around.
Mm-hmm.
And then going to be like, what's wrong with Chris? I'll be able to hold it together once I get everything out of my chest. I didn't say what I had to say. I'm good now.
But then he holding away.
He going to be like. So, yeah, I would. Demeanor probably going to be saying it, but I wouldn't say it.
All right.
But we get in the condo at home, be like, let me ask you something.
She more definitely, if she sees something she don't like, she more definitely gonna ask me on the way to the crib.
So what you gonna do in that same situation, Chris?
No, I'm waiting to get to the house.
Okay.
I wouldn't even throw the mood off. Yeah, I wouldn't, if I was to see something or try to, you know what I'm saying, if I feel like if I'm curious about something, I wouldn't do it there.
For one, my mama.
We'll be leaving. You know, yeah,
my mama
we'll be leaving early.
Okay.
We'll be leaving early.
And my mama-in-law gonna be like, y'all got it too.
Yep. She gonna act.
My
she gonna act.
Gonna
y'all
be
must
like,
be into it.
You and Chris must get into it.
I'm
good. But Chris is going to give it away. He gonna be sick. They didn't cook. He ain't finna eat nothing.
Y'all gonna have a doggone session.
I just can't handle it right then, like, cause I want to chop it up, get everything work together. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Just too much going on. So you know, I just that's why I be like kind of to myself because I can't take it at that point.
So. I feel you.
Yeah.
I feel you. So, so y'all.
But hey, if she see something she don't like or something, I'm gonna know how to meat rack that. You
gonna get to looking like
what could have possibly been in my
screenshot? You think this will make up bad? Y'all know, niggas. You
hey, don't go too ham.
I know. Screenshot it to your partner. Do this look like I'll be in the dog house for you. Yeah, I ain't gonna lie, man.
Yeah, you know how they is, bro.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, my dad got me
she called it cheating.
Heck no. So y'all would do a really pretty good job at, you know, just being on call with each other.
Yeah, I mean, but we had to learn it, though. You know what I'm saying? Like, you can't...
You can't put anybody in your beef.
Mm-mm.
That is true.
In your relationship, yeah. Period. Because, one, I ain't gonna lie, like, my mama, she ain't like that, like, she gonna be on both sides.
Mm-hmm.
But some people be like, we never had a scenario with my in-laws or whatever, but, so I can't say. But you know how it be like when you put your family in the business about your significant other, they make them be like,
they don't forget.
Yeah, I don't like, because she, you know, like she's
so
wrong.
Yeah, you gotta keep it in between y'all. You can't let,
because y'all gonna get back.
Yeah.
They're not gonna love y'all like y'all.
It's not their job to still like you after he start back like you.
Exactly.
So. Fact. And I feel like a lot of people need to, like, you know this, because a lot of people go to their friends and they go to their family members with their problem, and then get back with the girl, and the girl get back with the dude, whatever, however it go, and now the friend don't like.
Yeah, then you get the wrong.
Now you got to keep it separate. You know what I'm saying? You got to go in the other room and talk on the phone. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So
it's can't bring her around because the family really don't care for her. She feeling the back.
See, it's too much. It's too much.
You mad because you in the middle, but you stirred up out of this because you should have shut up.
Fact.
Okay. So take their advice. Don't be out here trying to be messy and involve everybody in y'all business.
Yeah.
And then look up and like, why didn't nobody like him? Yeah. Why they don't like her no more? Because you acted out of emotion and you got to talking too much.
For sure. Okay.
So what we're going to go ahead and get right into is Life After Tragedy. So Bree, go ahead and give them like a little glimpse on what we're going to be discussing today as far as what happened in your life.
Okay, so some of you all may know, most of you all may know, most of you all may not know. Before me and Chris got together, I experienced a boyfriend being killed. So before all of that, I'm gonna just give y'all a brief synopsis of my life. I went to college in 2014. I graduated 2018. I moved to Louisiana. After living in Louisiana for a few months, I moved to Texas on my own. So when I got to Texas, I had just started nail school. I was working for a juvenile detention center. I quit that job because I wanted to do nails full time. Mind you, I quit the job, but I did not have a clientele. Really, like a leap on faith. I didn't even have nail clients, but I said, I'm going to do nails full time. So cool, I'm living out there. I'm on my own, I'm minding my business. I'm doing what I want to do. Like, I wasn't in a relationship. I'm just popping shit. I met Chris on Instagram. We text, we talked, we linked up in the city or whatever. But he was kind of like still getting over a relationship. You know what I'm saying? That kind of did him bad or whatever. So he wasn't looking for a relationship. He was just wanting to be friends. Like, we cool, we laugh, we kick it, we talk, we chop it up. None more, none less.
Mm-hmm.
But you're sleeping with me, niggas ain't shit. So, of course, I'm in my feelings.
Because
I like Chris. I like too. He ain't like me too. So, that's neither here nor there. Me and Chris, we talking, we chopping it up. Okay, cool. For about a month or two. And then my boyfriend at the time who got killed, me and him was just friends. We dated in high school, broke up when I went to college, but we was always friends, always super cool. So he ended up hitting me up one day. I was in Memphis, we saw each other, ran into each other. One thing led to another, we ended up getting back together. Cool, I moved back to Memphis, October 2019. I left my apartment. I'm talking about not done with the lease. Like, it's eviction at this point because I just got up and left. Took my furniture, took everything, put everything on a U-Haul, moved back to Memphis in October. We moved in an apartment together in November and he was killed in December. So I was only in Memphis 3 months, really 2 months before he got killed. Well, December made that third month, at the beginning of December, because I moved back to Memphis October 4th.
Mm-hmm.
So we had November 4th, we moved into our apartment. December 9th, he got killed. Okay, so in the midst of that, before me and him started back talking, when I bumped into him, me and Chris was not talking. Chris had already decided, don't want to be in a relationship. I said, okay, not gonna keep begging you because I ain't chasing now, nigga. Did chase him a little bit, but I ain't chasing
it. It was a limited chase.
It was a limited chase. You hear me? Not like no 400 meter dash.
She didn't love me no more, y'all. She stopped loving me.
It wasn't no 400 meter dash. Let's start.
It was a speed walk.
It was a sprint.
Okay.
It was a sprint.
Okay.
It was a what?
It was a 100 meter.
Sprint. Still did run a little fast, but not too fast. So, I was late past my baton. So, me and Chris is not talking. He was still trying to, you know what I'm saying, hard eyes in the DM, nigga, bag, all about your business. So, okay, cool. Ryan gets killed, and everybody's hitting me up. I got so many texts, so many DMs, mm-hmm. so many people reaching out, like, I'm so sorry. Like, mm-hmm. Because it's kind of like, they watched the journey. Like, don't you feel like you just watched the journey?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We had literally just went live on Facebook, mm-hmm. so everybody was like, oh my God. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? I didn't know that so many people knew, like, my life. It's like, people was like, I'm so sorry you just moved back to Memphis and this happened to you. Mm-hmm. So I was like, dang, I didn't know I just moved back. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So it's kind of like everybody was like, so sorry. So in the midst of that, Chris had texted me too. Mm-hmm. I didn't even see the message because I had so much going on. Cool. Me and Chris link up probably like 2 weeks later, probably like 3 weeks later, because it was after the funeral and all of that. And he was just really genuinely trying to be my friend. Like, mm-hmm. of course you're not trying to be in a relationship with now. Right now, my boyfriend just got killed.
Right.
But he just felt like I saw all of this happen. Like, me and you was real close friends before this. I feel like I need to be there for you.
Yeah.
So I was like, okay, you know, I'll let you, you know, be there for me. When I tell you, as my friend, he was with me every day after that. Like, I think we linked up Christmas Eve, December 24th, and he invited me over his house with his family and everything. Mm-hmm. And I really was just, I was out of it. Like, I was just sitting there like,
no.
You know what I'm saying? They opening gifts, like they real family oriented. So it was so much love in the room, but I couldn't feel it. You know mm-hmm. what I'm saying? I was like, I texted him, I said, I want to go to my car. Cause I really wanted to just cry. But he went to the car with me, so I didn't cry. Because I was like, I want to scream, like I want to yell.
Because right.
I feel like nobody really feels or understands what I'm going through. Like, mm-hmm. everybody else, y'all good. Like, no tragic endings, no nothing. Like, it's me that's having to deal with this. On top of, we had an apartment together, so I'm like, do I still live here? Do I move out? I don't want to go here. You know, like, mm-hmm. it's just so much.
Mm-hmm.
So he was there, like, every day, every step of the way. I'm talking about endured so much from, like, me just having moments, breakdowns, like bipolarness. I felt mm-hmm. I was seeing a therapist and everything. Like, I was all over the place.
And grief.
And he never did leave my side. Like, I ain't gonna lie. He's strong, because I would have been like, dude, this ain't even my battle to fight. Hey, you got a lot going on.
Mm-hmm.
I'm gonna link up with you later on because I care about you. You know what I'm saying? I'm sorry that this happened to you, but just being on the other side, that was a lot to deal with.
Right. So. And it took somebody like Chris to deal with it.
Right.
So, like, with all that being said, Chris, she already said how, you know, y'all really went on that tip as far as you weren't ready to be in a relationship. Of course, she wasn't.
Mm-hmm.
So, during that time, would you say that you fell in love or had love, a whole lot of love, intimately for Ree before Ryan passed? Or did it really just develop afterwards to allow you to go ahead and be in that position to, you know, ride it out with her through all the stages of grief? So really, what I'm really wanting to see and understand is, was it your love for Ree that pretty much guided you through that time, or was it just who you are as a person and you just being a solid person like that allowed you to love her strongly and deeply during that process?
Well, our friendship was the one that really drawn me towards, like, brought me to her closer when the situation happened. Like,
mm-hmm.
me and her, people don't understand, like, she used to call me, you know. She never cheated on him or nothing like that. You know, never had no intent on cheating on him, but she used to call me, you know, had typical boyfriend, girlfriend problems, and she felt like she was comfortable to talk to me about that,
mm-hmm.
those things. And we just talk and we'd laugh. She'd tell me about her problem, I'd tell about my little problem. And it was just that. It was never nothing sexual, nothing, never trying to, you know, do anything, nothing like that. It just was a genuine friendship that we had. So once it happened, it was like, I don't know, I think it was just God talking to me, like, you know.
Get in there.
Yeah, she mm-hmm. like, your voice matters. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So
you felt like you was the person that can get through
yeah,
to her.
Yeah, because, like I said, I kind of knew her a little bit, far as like, I know she'll shut you out. And then something like this, I already know she going off the, you know, deep end. Especially when I seen on Facebook, I was like, oh yeah, she losing it right now. I knew she was. So, you know, and that just come from like just knowing each other, just getting to know each other. Like she said, we had already been talking before her and Ryan got together. A lot of people don't know that. You know what I'm saying? Like, they thinking that we just kicked it off. Nah,
yeah, like a lot of people looked at it like, damn, she got a new boyfriend quick. Like,
yeah, we been chopping yeah. it up. Like, we been, you know what I'm saying, kicking it. We been, like, she a cop from Texas while she at work. Like, we been having that strong relationship as far as a friendship. So I think that would draw me towards her as far as, like, you know, just being there for our friendship. And then the love for her grew
mm-hmm.
once we started getting.
Because he was with me every day.
Yeah, I mean, of course, you're going to, if you around somebody every day, of course, you're going to start loving, some type of loving for them. I mean, liking going to start, you know.
Turning
that's just, yeah, that's just anything. You know, this is with anything. Like a dog, you know, you around every day, a stray dog, they come around every day, you take them in, you're going to start loving that dog. Mm-hmm. So. It's just, yeah, the love grew, and it just got strong and strong, and then, you know, we're here now, so.
It's a real blessing.
Yeah.
So, it honestly does take a lot of strength and emotional and spiritual stamina. So, how did you keep your cup full enough, and who was your support emotionally? Where did you draw your strength from emotionally and spiritually to even be able to have enough to pour into her?
I just had to bring on to, like, just show her what I got and how I cope with what I'm going through.
Mm-hmm.
And that was laughter. Me and Derica laugh every day, all day, and I made sure I did that to keep her mind off a lot of stuff. You know what I'm saying? Keep her out that deep hole, keep her out that dark little, you know what I'm saying? Try to keep her from having them little spaz outs that she had.
Mm-hmm.
Just, you know what I'm saying? I tried to, because that's our connection. Like, I don't know if a lot of people, I know they know now, but me and her is like, we like perfectly for each other because, mm-hmm. you know, everybody ain't for me. You know, I come from a relationship where I wasn't accepted. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So a lot of things that we did together, and I feel like she felt that authentic connection. That kind of took her mind off a lot of them things that was going on, you know what I'm saying, and what she went through and stuff like that. So it's really like, it's kind of like a scientific thing. Like, it's like a chess move. I had to make the right move when it was supposed to be made at that moment, not mm-hmm. just, you know what I'm saying, period, like that moment. Certain stuff you got to say right then at that moment, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
So.
You got to be ready for it.
He really didn't have, like, a lot of people, Chris is real secretive, like a lot of, he didn't have nobody to, outside of him being with me, like, he didn't have nobody to be like, you know, because really he didn't tell nobody what was going on.
Mm-hmm.
Like, his family was like, this nigga done went missing. Where is he? Like, why you don't come around? You don't. And he felt like it wasn't that he was neglecting his family or, you know what I'm saying, not trying to show them the same love. It's just he felt like in that time, I needed him more. And in a mm-hmm. sense,
you were his assignment.
Right.
That's exactly what it was.
And in a sense, I did, but, like, they didn't know in depth
yeah.
what really was going on. Like, I was, girl, it was, and it's like only Chris could do that. Like, I was in my mom, I remember being in my mom's house one time, like, just laying in her guest bedroom, just crying. She couldn't get me to stop crying. Like, she was like, what's the guy name? What's the guy name that, you know, be with you? Like, what? She was like, call him. She was mm-hmm. like, give me his number. She was mm-hmm. talking about Chris.
Mm-hmm.
And she was like, can you get over here? Like, I know you can, you the one that can soothe this. Like, you can stop this crying. Can you get over here? So Chris was like, well, I can, but I ain't got a way right now. She was like, I'll pay for it. He was like, I'm an Uber. And he came over there. I went straight to sleep.
It's was peace.
Like, yeah, it was like nobody else could do that. You know what mm-hmm. I'm saying? Like, not even my mama. So.
That's a blessing. So what would you say, like, during that time, Chris, what were the four major emotions that you would say you experienced during that time of just that healing period for Reed?